ladies and gentlemen. My name is Gertz Richter. I'm the president of the Senior Schubert Society. And I'm so thrilled and excited to welcome the wonderful Graham Johnson. But before I do so, I should pay respects to the traditional owners of the land on which this conservatorium is built, and acknowledge their wonderful contribution to our culture. Now, as the president of the Sydney Schubert Society, a title, "Do We Need Schubert in Our Time?" doesn't require a lecture. It requires a short answer, "Of course." But I think it's a wonderful idea to hear from Graham, Dr. Johnson, about this topic, because of course, as you all know, and the members of the Schubert Society are here, and I don't have to explain to you, he is the foremost living expert on the music of Schubert, I think. His three-volume wonderful work on Schubert's Lieder is absolutely path-breaking. It's also very expensive and out of print, but I recommend for you to buy it. It's a wonderful book, and it's a lifelong gift to your love for Schubert. So that's the advertising for your sales. And please make Dr. Johnson welcome. We're thrilled to have you here and see. Thank you.
Gentlemen, I wanted to speak tonight about Schubert's place in the world, but in order to understand that, we have to give you a bit of context. And in talks like this, I prefer not to assume that I'm speaking to a world of Schubert specialists or classical music specialists. So for those of you who know a great deal of what I'm going to say in the beginning, I ask your forgiveness, because I think sometimes even the great connoisseurs need to be reminded, or don't mind being reminded, of certain basic facts in musical history. And where Schubert fits in his own time is very relevant to why he remains relevant to all of us, to the modern world. I want to talk about an extraordinary period in cultural history. Basically, after the French Revolution, or just before and after the French Revolution, leading right through to the middle 1860s and later, when Vienna stood at the center of the musical world. There was no place to rival it. London, a powerful, already imperial city, had the edge on Vienna in almost every commercial sphere, in questions of money, growing imperial power, scientific experiment in the 1820s, construction of railways, the use of gas, the use of steam. Schubert, who died in 1828 in Vienna, never saw a railway, never saw even a steamship coming up the Danube. His exact contemporary, William Blake, that famous poet and bemoaner of the dark satanic mills of industrialization, was much better informed about all those British specialties, mills and child labor and chimney sweeps and all sorts of Victorian horrors to be uncovered and generally talked about by Dickens. Vienna was a small place. It still had the old city walls. It was powerful only in the sense that it was the center of a large empire, but it was by no means as powerful as neighboring Prussia, that Prussia that was eventually to crush the rest of Germany under its heel and to become a great empire in the 1870s. But Vienna was, as it remains today, a very comfortable place to be. I think it's right at the top of the list of livable cities. What I love about it is because it was so constructed for imperial usage that it's got large spaces. One can always seem to find a place in a restaurant. One can always seem to find a place to rent. At one point, Vienna was full of Hungarians and Czechs and people from Silesia and people from Bosnia, all part of this huge Habsburg Empire. Now, it's simply Austria. But between the French Revolution and the later points of the 19th century, it was a musical city second to none. And that's not only because it had good singers and good orchestras and good players, it had great composers. For some reason, it was a magnet. It was a place where great composers liked to live. And that has endured in musicological history as the Vienna Classics. So when people talk about the Vienna Classics, they talk about Joseph Haydn, they talk about Mozart, they talk about Beethoven, they talk about Schubert, they come one after the other in a vivid succession. And then, as a postlude, Johannes Brahms, who just about might be considered in some way part of the Vienna Classics. It remains the central point of European musical history. And every other town in Europe was aware of it. Paris, London, even America was aware of Vienna's importance. It remains still the only city that one goes about and finds random statues of Beethoven and Goethe or Schiller or Johann Strauss. There's a beautiful statue of Schubert in the Stadtpark. And well, anybody who's musical and values musical living is really enchanted for the first time in Vienna, because instead of the opera house being somewhere else, it's really at the end of the Kärntnerstrasse, the most busy street, pedestrian precinct. So walking from your shopping into the opera house is the most natural thing in the world. Admittedly, in Schubert and Mozart's time, it isn't the same opera house, or at least the city has changed enormously in the time of Franz Joseph. But we shouldn't over-concern ourselves with how the city has changed. I just want to tell you a little bit about the progress of the people. Joseph Haydn was born not in Vienna, but in a provincial part of Austria, soon drawn to Vienna, and spent much of his life in service to Prince Esterházy in Eisenstadt and Esterháza, not far from Vienna. In his later years, when he could give up his role as a liveried servant to Prince Esterházy, he came to Vienna and lived there. What sort of a person was Haydn? Adorable. His music tells it all. The great father of the string quartet, of the symphony, not such a great opera composer, but he wrote very many. The man who represented the liveried place of servants, who then became freer with money and success, and was bold enough in the 1790s, to traverse war-torn France, cross the Channel, come to England, celebrated in England by everybody, had an enormous success on two successive trips, write symphonies and pieces of music for the English market. He is a person who was a charm. But let's talk a bit about his private life. Unhappily married to a woman who didn't suit him at all, the Haydns soon began to make their own arrangements, and he had a number of affairs with various people, ending up with one actually in St. James's in London, a widow of whom he was extremely fond. He was very much the avuncular father figure without children, but nevertheless a person who occupied a seminal place in Austrian and world musical history. People are so bound up with Mozart that they forget the importance of Haydn. And he was generous. He was not too happy to have to be a teacher to the young and romantic Ludwig van Beethoven, who arrived from Germany to be a student and thought he knew it all. But he was extremely generous to Wolfgang Mozart. I know of no composer greater than your son, Haydn wrote to Leopold Mozart. He is a great master. I love the thought of Haydn in his 50s asking Mozart if he could sit in on the rehearsals of the first performance of Così fan tutte, an opera that was so far beyond Haydn's own abilities as a dramatist, a wonderful libretto by Lorenzo da Ponte. But the thought of Haydn sitting in a chair and listening to that extraordinary trio in Così fan tutte of Don Alfonso, Fiordaligia and Dorabella, and hearing those musical undulations for the first time, and putting his hand through his face and realizing that this young man literally was a god. Not that Haydn was not a god in his own way, but I will say this. The man who can salute his younger contemporaries with love and admiration is a properly grounded and special individual. There's a sanity about Joseph Haydn. So there he is, very different from the Berlin composers, names that you probably wouldn't know these days. Completely different from that extraordinary tradition of church music in distant Leipzig in Saxony that represents Bach. But that was an earlier period. Other great figures are Gluck, the great opera composer, also in his time drawn to Vienna. Everybody wanted to go to Vienna who valued music. Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart was not born there, he was born in Salzburg, and he too was born into a situation where the archbishop controlled everything in the city, and he had to make his freedom evident. He toured the world, toured Europe as a child. He was a child prodigy, and this was an incandescent genius. I'm sure I don't have to sell you the greatness of Wolfgang Amadeus. But that he should be Haydn's contemporary, and that he should also inevitably, after tussling in Salzburg, thinking perhaps of getting a job in Mannheim, he came to Vienna and worked. And we have that extraordinary period in the late 1870s, the late 1780s, when he was, you know, one work came after the other, Figaro and Così fan tutte and Don Giovanni. Sadly, he was to die at 36, and the Zauberflöte, the magic flute, was to be his last work. Schubert, as a young man, once wrote, "Oh, Mozart, immortal Mozart, what great joys you brought into the world." And the thing about this tradition is that if you've got Haydn and you've got Mozart clever enough to know that although he's a once-in-a-millennium genius, he can learn from Haydn, you know, because that's also very important. Great geniuses always know from whom they can learn. So here you've got two Austrians, one of them living all the way to 1809, Haydn, the bombardment of Napoleon entering into that city and taking over, one of his last memories. His two great oratorios, The Creation and The Seasons, enabling people to almost deify him in terms of his importance. And then Mozart, dead by this time, 1756 to 1791. Too soon gone, but an unbelievable lingering presence. The great Goethe, poet from Weimar, never visited Vienna because there was a side of Germans who thoroughly distrusted the Austrians, politically and personally. And it is true that Vienna can be full of a certain beguiling type of rather two-faced charm. The charm of the survivor, the Turkish invasion of the 1680s had almost succeeded. Vienna caught in the middle of all powers, trying to be all things to all men. The slithery attitude of charm that really is disguised hostility, Wiener Schmäh. And then, suddenly in musical history, another great, enormous personage comes into the mix. Just before Mozart died, a young man born in 1770, brought up in Bonn, a Rhinelander, dark, dusky, good looks, a firebrand, a great Lothario, an astounding improviser, an incredible pianist, hard to convince, hard to teach. Haydn gave up, very uncharmed. But when we talk of Ludwig van Beethoven, despite the fact that Mozart can never be bettered, we suddenly have injected into the small, neighborly, beautiful town with its city walls another gigantic colossus. It's almost as if the gods are showering the city with the proliferation of people. Haydn, the lovely, slightly naughty older man. Mozart, happily married to Constanze Weber. Children, but in some respects a dark horse. Was he in love with the English soprano Nancy Storrs, or Storace, that great piece with piano and orchestra and voice, Kill Miss Florida D.D.? Was Nancy Storrs Mozart's lover, where we are beginning to feel that Mozart was more complicated? Where was his money going? Why was he designated a pauper? There's a lot of legends about Mozart being killed by Salieri or poisoned, and that he wrote the Requiem in his last days, that very famous piece. But Mozart has nothing in terms of willpower, grandeur, and in a sense, a ways of living, completely unaware and unthinking of their general populace, are numbered. The artist as hero, the artist as person who tells his donors and so-called protectors financially what he wants and he expects to get it. Beethoven's story is a miraculous one if you like the story of a strong-willed, mighty man rising to the heights of his own power. And how can you object? Any performance of Fidelio, any performance of the Mrs. Lettres, any performance of the late piano sonatas or quartets, the man is truly as big as he thought he was. Awkward that. We normally prefer people who think they're big not to be so big after all. Same applies to Wagner, by the way, who some of us would prefer not to be so famous. Not so much of a genius as well as someone so aware of his own genius. So here we have a man who had a private tragedy, Beethoven, with deafness. That deafness that suddenly overtook him and which rendered a part of his life sad and pathetic. Also his relationship with women. Many women in his life, certainly when he was a young man, he made love often, and certainly he had a type of incredible charisma as a performer that would have had many women fall at his feet. But he was an idealist about women and could never reconcile sexual passion with idealized companionship. Obviously, the sexual passion in a place like Vienna was easy to come by. In 1814, in the wake of Napoleon's defeat, there was a congress in Vienna that brought the entire crown heads of Europe in a big conference to decide how on earth they were going to regulate the rest of the world. It was a great anti-revolutionary right-wing conclave to ensure that something like the French Revolution and the horrors of Napoleon, who only came about thanks to the French Revolution, would never happen again. A hard swing to the right. The Tsar of Russia came with thousands of people. Castlereagh came from England. Talleyrand came from France. A vast group of secretaries, and Vienna was filled with thousands of people. And to serve them, thousands and thousands of prostitutes of every persuasion. Ah, Vienna was full of that possibility. So Beethoven would never have gone short, but he adored passionate, difficult romances, often with people who were married, and the relationships were perhaps not consummated or secret or hidden, or simply a question of loving letters. For years it was unknown who the immortal beloved was. There was someone referred to as the unsterbliche Geliebte, the immortal beloved. Suffice it to say that he represented, in the way that the whole of Vienna and all the aristocracy who knelt at his feet in adulation, he represented the triumph of the artist as masculine, testosterone full heroism, shaking his fist at fate, determined to make intractable music. He was not as much of a natural musician as Mozart. his notebooks. He bent themes so that, I mean, he worked hard, like as if he were working in a city, making his music work. And yes, there was no arguing with his ascendancy. Haydn had died, Mozart had died. Somebody asked him, who in your opinion is the world's greatest composer? And Beethoven looked horrified at the man, and the man said, oh yeah, apart from you, of course. Oh, he said, probably Cherubini, the French composer. Tonight's talk is not about Beethoven, but you have to know what it feels like to be a young person with that type of tradition. How do you get born into a world where Haydn's music resounds and Mozart's music is everywhere, including his operas? And Beethoven, who after all only died in 1827, is to be seen walking, sometimes disheveled, living the life of a completely uncontrollable bachelor. People terrified of displeasing him. People paying him to remain in Vienna whenever he threatened to leave the city. A national treasure. Not afraid in the slightest of the big aristocrats. What a distance since Haydn's title had to appear in servant's livery. Beethoven was all know that that type of composer attracts a lot of opprobrium from people today who regard classical music as the province of dead white males. He was white and he was male. Definitely male, despite the fact that his exploits, again, we don't have that many details, but we know that he was deeply in love with various women throughout his life. But he preferred to live alone. He never wanted to marry. His greatest emotional attachment was as guardian to his nephew Karl, inherited from his dead brother. He looked after the boy. That was a whole chapter of sorrow, sadness, and difficulty in his life. But there was this immortal beloved, and there was an opera called Fidelio about a woman who saved her husband from imprisonment and death through her resilience, brilliance, and bravery. That's what Fidelio is about. The greatness of Leonora. So there we have someone from Aurora outside Vienna, Haydn, someone from Salzburg. Surely it was time for Vienna to produce one of its own. And ladies and gentlemen, that's where Franz Schubert comes in. His parents were both poor from Silesia, one of the outposts of the Austrian Empire. They made their way separately in separate families. His mother's family, because there'd been a disgrace of some theft from union funds. They came to Vienna to better their lives, like countless immigrants do, thinking that life in the big city would be easier. Schubert's father was a schoolmaster, but not a schoolmaster that you'd recognize from a good genteel school. His specialty was schooling the brats of people who would only get a few years' education until they were sent off to work. The rudiments, and in a poor part of Vienna, the 9th district, the Nussdorferstrasse, that's where Franz Peter Seraphicus Schubert, one of 14 children, seven of whom survived, and of those seven, not for long. Five actually survived. Outliving Schubert himself. So he was the youngest boy, and the father was strangely musical to the extent of string quartets, bad musical playing. The mother, one of the great mysteries of musical history, because we know so little about her. But I am convinced that she knew that her little boy was musical. She spoiled him, she looked after him. A mother knows when a child is something very, very special. And I think she was very musical herself. And I've got no doubt that he inherited his genius from his mother's side of the family. His siblings were not so highly favored. Certainly not his brother Ferdinand, who was a very bad composer indeed. So we have this boy, unlike Mozart, who had a clever, savvy father who sent the whole family touring and playing to the crowned heads of Europe. Schubert had an unexceptional childhood, but he showed musical promise. He sang for an audition at the age of 9 or 10 and got a scholarship to the Hofburg Kapelle as a choir boy in the Imperial Chapel. In return, he was given education at the Imperial Convict, a place where they had an orchestra, there was a musical life, and there were a lot of boys there of a much higher social standing. And so Schubert did that classic thing of going to school and finding that he fitted in with the boys of greater talent, education, background, libraries, parents who were richer than his dictatorial father, his overworked, over-childbearing mother who died in any case when he was 14, and a father who was determined that all this nonsense about professional musical life was going to be forgotten, and Franz was going to take his place in the family business, teaching children and beating the living daylights out of them if they didn't learn their alphabet or do their reading. By 11 or 12, Schubert was composing. Oh no, not operas and symphonies like Mozart. But he was, right from the beginning, not only a song composer. Now, I'm sitting here talking about him because he was the world's greatest ever song composer. But the great thing about him, just like all his Vienna school people who'd come before him, his predecessors, he mastered every musical form. And there were two forms that he made his own and in which he has never been better. That is the piano duet, in which he was an extremely important pioneer, and the piano accompanied song. Yes, Haydn had written songs with piano, Mozart had written songs with piano, some. Beethoven had written some. But Schubert brought the art of song composing to a completely new and special height. Right from the beginning, however, he was also writing orchestral music, overtures, piano music, masses, and by that I mean church music. Not because he was religious, His father was a religious fanatic. He was someone who doubted God almost from the beginning, like his elder brother Ignaz, who infuriated the father because he openly said he didn't believe in God. Picture this then, a cuckoo in the nest, the mother dead, fortunately a stepmother who was kind, and the father, well, quite simply a tyrant. A lot of Schubert's problems, insufficiencies, neuroses and sadnesses came about because of his father. There is a feeling in Catholic Austria at the time that the father is the god of the family. He can do with his children as he wishes and as he sees fit. He is not to be questioned. He was enormously capable of enormous physical punishment. That Schubert was beaten to perdition is not officially recorded, but I'm absolutely convinced it was the case. The father withheld a certain amount of love from the boy. He didn't fit in. He wasn't like the other sons. Something too soft about him, something too vulnerable, something of a mummy's boy. Thus, it seemed a very good idea to send him off to boarding school. Mind you, only 35 minutes walk from the 9th district to the 1st district where the school was, but it's another world in the Erste Bezirk, the first district in Vienna, another world. So Schubert goes there and meets a whole lot of hoity-toity, clever people whose parents work as senior civil servants and administrators and lots of fonds. Josef von Spahn. Franz von Schlechter, aristocrats. And the terrifying thing is that Schubert felt at home in their company. And he loved. He loved what he could borrow from them in terms of books and invited back sometimes to their homes. And, oh, it was so different. The food was different. The whole way of life was different. But there is evidence in some of the selection of Schubert's early texts for his songs that father issues were very much to the forefront. He longed for the love of his father and never truly received it. The father never turned up once to hear one of his son's performances. It's true the father in 1814 bought him a piano, but only because he'd written a successful mass, and the father counted a mass as important because he was a very, very devout Catholic. What I'm trying to say is that this is another world from the rest of the Vienna classics. Admittedly, Haydn had to work his way up, and he had his own struggle from a working class family. Mozart was really upper middle class. Beethoven had problems at home, but by the time he'd arrived in Vienna, he was on the crest of a wave. But Schubert, he astounded his school friends. He composed. He played the violin better than others, and he won the support of older friends like Josef von Spahn, who bought him music paper and who wondered at his musicality. And when the early songs of Schubert were written, he used to show them to his friends, and they couldn't believe it. The famous Earl König, the Earl King, that most famous of songs, a father rides with the sun through the night, trying to save his life. There's thundering horse hooves. There is a huge amount of tension. And on the way, the spirit evil of the Earl King tries to lure the boy away, to suck out his spirit. I'm now convinced that when Schubert set that poem, what made his heart race was the idea of a father holding him closely and thinking it worthwhile to ride through the night to save his son. Er hält ihm sicher. Er hält ihm warm. The security and warmth of his father is what Schubert lacked. Whatever was going on in his juvenile mind, fate lavished as many gifts on young Franz Schubert as had been lavished on any of the other great Vienna classics. But the problem is, Haydn, Mozart, and Beethoven had a healthy self-esteem between them, despite their problems. Mozart was perfectly aware that he was cleverer, more adept, more brilliant than anyone else alive in the musical world. The flaw in Franz Schubert's cradle of gifts that the fairies bestowed on him was lack of self-esteem. This was compounded and a matter all his life of a problem by the fact that in order to be a real composer, one had to have a big public success. He was not a virtuoso pianist like Beethoven. He couldn't go and he was a very good pianist. If you could write a successful opera, you would be hugely rewarded and regarded and seen. Do you know that in 1819 he managed to write an opera that was performed in the Kärntner Theatre? It was an opera for the singer Vogel, who became his mentor, called Die Zwillingsbrüder. And it was a reasonable success, and they called for the composer to take a bow. And he wouldn't go and take a bow. At the moment that he could have begun his progress, he shied away from grasping any concept of success. One of the great mysteries is why Schubert took so long to become world famous, decades after his life. All the others were famous in their own lifetime. It's nothing to do with the music. It's how you sell yourself. It's how you perceive yourself. It's how you market yourself. Then as now, if you don't believe in yourself, others won't believe in you. And if you think that your work will do all the talking, you are sadly mistaken, because people are not so perspicacious. Yes, a few are, but not enough. Added to which, there is a There's a mystery about this composer. In 1913 and again in 1950, Otto Erich Deutsch, who was the greatest of all original Schubert scholars, compiled a volume called Schubert, a Documentary Biography. It was the first time that such a biography had ever been done. Instead of an interpretation of the life, you just got all the letters, all the documents, and you could piece them together and see how they fit in chronological order, but what happened between them, you don't know. There are many letters, not a single love letter among them. According to those documents, Schubert never ever had a relationship. He certainly was never engaged, he certainly was never married, he never mentions women in his letters, he never shares. There is an element of reserve. We know a great deal more from Beethoven's letters, let me tell you, and Mozart's, volumes of them. Haydn might have been a bit more discreet because he was having affairs strictly, as it were, adulterously. So the real Schubert, from the point of view of what made his heart race, what made him fall in love, these things are unknown. And this has led, ladies and gentlemen, to great conjecture. There are all sorts of answers and putative answers. As soon as Schubert was dead, his contemporaries came up with a vast fund of stories. Now we know that some of them are nonsense. I was his closest friend. I inspired him to Schoenemüller, and it's easy to be the best friend of a composer once he's dead. He told me, said one person, that he was in love with a woman called Teresa Grob and wanted to marry her, but didn't have the money to do so. It's true, there's a Teresa Grob. She was the high soprano in his very first mass, Deutsch 105. The other person is Carolina Esterházy. He was a tutor for two summers in 1818 and 1824 in Zelitz, then in Hungary, at the home of another Esterházy, not the same Esterházy as Haydn's. And there were two girls and many hours of Schubert studies have putatively thought or imagined that he was so in love with Carolina Esterházy, Princess Carolina, Countess, so far out of his league, conveniently so. And yes, she was a very nice girl. And yes, they made lovely music together. And yes, the great Fantasia in F minor for piano duet, a really extraordinary piece of music, is dedicated to her. But can it be that he nurtured in silence this huge, huge love? There's not a word from him, it's all friends. Because what's very important when somebody dies is that you get his image right, because he's a great national treasure. There are a few people who spoke out. A friend of Schubert's called Anton Kenner, who said, sadly for Schubert, he was awash with sensuality. and his passions were bathed in mud, in schlammer gebadet. And suddenly you see in that little glimmer of information something about the composer. Did we really think that this nice man with the balding head and cheerful glasses, so short and overweight, was actually vibrating with deep passions? Well, why not? Have you heard his music? Is this the music of a eunuch? Is this the music of someone who never knows longing? Certainly not. In the late 1990s, a musicologist called Maynard Solomon, distinguished American musicologist, wrote an essay in 19th Century Music which proposed the possibility that Franz Schubert was homosexual. He was immediately denounced. There's one Canadian woman scholar who said that she will fight to her dying breath to save Franz Schubert from the calumny of homosexuality, accusing Maynard Solomon of wanting Schubert to be as queer as he was. Poor Maynard Solomon, distinguished grandfather as he was. If you say he's gay, you must be gay. Well, to a certain extent, we all want Schubert to be how we are, ladies and gentlemen, because he's loved. Those who love him not like some inaccessible, brilliant star Mozart, or like some gigantic Beethoven. They love him because he's personable, because he seems like us, because he seems so deeply human, because he seems so close to us. So if he liked a bit to drink, we are happy if we liked a bit to drink. If he's not a church person, then we're happy if we're not church people. But what about the people who are religious and try to prove that so was he because he wrote so many masses? He couldn't have drunk too much because the sheer amount of music, over 700 songs and vocal part songs, 9 symphonies, 10 operas, any numbers of sonatas, string quartets. The complete edition of Schubert in my library goes from that microphone stand to the end of the table in a row of books. Age 31 he died. You can't imagine many drunken mornings spent not working. But in terms of the sexuality, it's amazing. Not that Maynard Solomon's arguments were necessarily the best ones or the only ones. But particularly Austrians fought hard against Schubert. There's a whole field of scholarship that wanted to romanticize Schubert since the 1920s. Is anybody here old enough to remember a musical called Lilac Time, or a film starring Richard Tauber as Schubert with the monocle and a Schubert lookalike? It's all extremely clear that the three maidens that he was supposedly in love with had never existed. Which brings me to the central thesis, ladies and gentlemen, of what I'm talking about in general. When you have got such a musical hero in place as Beethoven, what about a composer for our own times who's different, who's a loser, who's not a great big masculine titan figure, who's softer. I wonder how many of you know that the song form was considered something feminine, and that Schubert, right through to George Bernard Shaw's time, was condemned as a nothing of a composer because he was writing songs, and songs were women's work. To be a hero, you have to write the Ninth Symphony, or the Victory Symphony of Beethoven. Well, I'm here to tell you, look closely, because Schubert wrote his own great C major symphony. It isn't an ode to joy, but it's a masterpiece. So I'm actually saying, if we go through the music of Schubert, if we go through his sad life, we find things, particularly in our revised, more modern attitude to people who are different, we find a corrective. Unfortunately, we don't find in the Vienna classics a great female composer. There is a great female composer in Berlin called Fanny Hensel Mendelssohn, Felix Mendelssohn's sister, a really great composer and even more of a strong figure than her brother. But let's talk about the people who are great in gift but riddled with guilt because they disappoint their parents, because their contemporaries, to justify their friendship, have to lie about them and make up stories. If you want to know my reading of the situation, I'll give it to you in a few words or a few salient sequences. And I say this after a lifetime of research and a lifetime of pondering and a lifetime of looking at that volume of letters that we actually have and trying to see not the mistaken evidence of made-up stories that can't be verified from people long after the composer's death, but what we actually have from Schubert himself. And that particular situation is to do with one of the people who was a lifelong friend, born in Sweden, educated in Vienna from a very free-thinking and louche background. Tall, handsome, charismatic, very literary, aware of the latest poetry. I wonder how many of you know the name Franz von Schubert. It amused Schubert to combine himself with Schubert, so he was called Schubert. Franz von Schubert was an opportunist, but he had the good sense to know that this young man was his passport, perhaps, to immortality. He was not very good at anything, Schubert. He was a bit of this and a bit of that. A bit of a poet, a bit of a librettist. And when Schubert couldn't bear living at home anymore in 1816, he and his generous mother and sister invited Schubert to share their apartment. And Schubert found that friendship with Schubert and never varied in his friendship despite everything. A year following, in 1817, Schubert wrote a poem, "Du holde Kunst," it begins. It's the song An die Musik, one of the greatest pieces of music ever written by Schubert, with its haunting postscript. And Schubert set it to music, not as a hymn to music, does he have to thank music? Everything that he has is music. It is the great piece that it is because it is Franz von Schubert. Just like the young boy in the cycle, Die Schöne Millerin, who looks at a distance at something he can never have. I firmly believe that Franz von Schubert, and he has form because life is being researched, was one of those people who adored adoration from wherever it came, male or female, who used adoration as power, who twirled people around his little finger and enjoyed doing so, who had certain generous and very cultivated responses, undoubtedly. And Franz von Schubert, his ambition was to become a librettist to a great composer's opera. In the meantime, he threw open all sorts of doors. He organized a singer vogel, 1821. Oh, he was terribly well connected. This is rich upper class connections. Atzenburg, a castle outside Vienna, the Schubertians moved there and had a summer on the land, playing charades and going in carriage rides and having a wonderful time. And in 1821, for two glorious months, Schubert and Schubert shared a room and together wrote an opera. This is what Schubert wanted. Certainly, I'm convinced this is what Paul Schubert wanted. How much he gambled, how much he delivered, how much he didn't deliver, we'll never know. I imagine the expression is that emotionally Schubert lived off the smell of an oil rag. They wrote that opera. It's an opera that has never received its due. It's got a thoroughly bad libretto by Franz von Schubert and some remarkably beautiful music by Franz Schubert. And the name of the opera is Alfonso und Estrella. They brought it back to Vienna in 1822, and it was rejected because no German operas were allowed by the Italian intendant, who was only interested in Rossini. At which point, having failed, and Schubert having failed to get him his opera, he decided to go to Breslau and become an actor. As he fancied himself on the stage. And he left Vienna, left Schubert. Within months, Schubert had gone to the dogs. Whatever money he had, he started frequenting, well, the official story, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, is that Schubert acquired his syphilis by visiting a prostitute at Schubert's direction. Now, if that is the official story, the truth is a great deal worse. That I've learned about Vienna. What kind of prostitute? Oh, for God's sake, Schubert might have said, go and get some experience. Anyway, he felt abandoned, and you should read the heartbreaking letters. These letters exist in black and white. Nobody can be to me what you were, beloved Schubert. Oh, they are the only, and Schubert is the recipient of the most passionate mentions in all of Schubert's writing. Still, there are some people saying there are lots of girls, letters that have disappeared, things, there is not a single letter of Schubert that mentions the name of a female that he finds enchanting, beautiful, delightful. Nothing. Not a single intimation, never mind a romance, affair, a sexual liaison. Nothing even about what the Germans call a Neigung, a leaning, an enthusiasm. And then Schubert finds himself in this screaming disease and has to go back and live in the schoolhouse and tell his incredibly rectitudinal father that he's got a terrible illness. And we don't know anything about the reaction, we don't know anything that happened because 1823 is a dark year. There's very little information. And then Schubert goes through this watershed moment of the Schöne Melodie about a boy who has a loser, a boy who tries to love someone who doesn't love him back. Oh, I forgot to tell you that Schöne revealed to Schubert that he'd been secretly engaged to a girl called Justina von Bruckmann, the sister of one of Schubert's friends, and this whole situation so enraged the girl's brother that the whole Schubert circle was split apart by the scandal. And then Schubert goes off to Breslau to be an actor. And poor Schubert is left high and dry. He realizes that he can never again have a relationship, that he has this illness, he has terrifying mercury poisoning because of steam baths and mercury that are incredibly painful, the consumption of mercury that causes him to lose his hair. He writes the cycle. He feels suicidal, and we know this about his poetry. Schubert writes poems when he's in extremis, and only then. Let me wash myself in Lethe, he said, and be born again. Well, ladies and gentlemen, what he does is he bathes himself via that boy in the brook. He writes a story in a type of transference and a type of enormous therapeutic psychological. If you imagine listening to music as therapeutic, can you imagine what writing it could be? As it vibrates through you for the first time. He writes this music, and the end of the cycle, the poor miller boy rejected by the girl, all his hopes of love finished, and he drowns himself, the very thing that Schubert had mentioned about drowning himself immediately in his poem. And then something utterly miraculous happens. Yes, he's ill for the rest of his life. He doesn't die of syphilis, however. He doesn't live long enough to have the syphilis reach the brain. But he frees himself of bitterness. He comes to terms with the fact that he simply has to live without the love that he'd craved, without his father's love. By the way, in 1822, he writes down a dream that would have fascinated Freud. My father invited me into a beautiful garden with a wonderful meal, and he said, eat, eat, you should eat. But the whole thing disgusted me. I couldn't partake and do what he wanted. And my father hit me. We have that in his own hand. So here is this person denied, giving forth love with every pore of his being and in every note he writes, improvising dances non-endingly at the piano while the young ladies and gentlemen danced around him, bringing him the occasional beer and patting him on the head. The person who's never tall enough, never Keatsian enough, never beautiful enough or Byronic enough to attract love and attention. The person who thinks badly of himself, who's consumed with guilt, who knows that no one on the planet is writing better music than he is. At the same time, failure unworthy of physical or emotional love, which my God has been compensated by all your love and mine and the millions of others ever since, that flow to him posthumously. But that's the point. The lack of ego, the lack of cunning. He'd written 200 songs in print. He couldn't capitalize. He couldn't make himself a big name. He didn't care to. He preferred to hide. And when people hide, it's a symptom of feeling out of kilter. The parental opposition and disgust probably continued to his death. His brother was kind. Schubert eventually returned from Breslau, having thoroughly failed to make a life as an actor, and then proceeded to try and be a printer of music, which also thoroughly failed. He then eventually went to Weimar to be Liszt secretary, and that thoroughly failed. Everything he did failed because he was all charm and hot air. It is my conviction that Schubert wasted a number of years of his life completely entranced by someone who was not worthy of that affection. Someone who didn't return the love. And someone in the lack of love who sent him into dangerous experimentations driven by desperation. And who knows where, there were plenty of male prostitutes in Vienna. Who knows where and how? But the illness, the treatment, the Schönebiller, and then 4.5 years of glorious music. That's the triumph. Music making, the late piano sonatas, the E flat major mass, the Winterreiser, never for a moment allowing his private disappointments and his private sorrows to stem the flow of that music, which was his special responsibility in the world to deliver. He'd been sent to this earth. Well, Brahms wrote of him much later, and Brahms, who came to Vienna from Hamburg and was the last bastion of that Viennese school until the second Viennese school of avant-garde composers later on, Berg and Webern and Schönberg. Brahms wrote of Schubert, he plays in gardens to which we do not have the key. Every day at 8 a.m, through his veins and down onto the quill of the paper, and with greater reliability following his illness and crisis, flawlessly masterpiece after masterpiece. So my contention is, ladies and gentlemen, that instead of seeing a block of white male composers, you've got a different kettle of fish with Franz Schubert. A person who might have had a kinder, more understanding father today. A person, who knows, who might have had better luck in placing his affections, and who indeed we have no idea if Schubert had lived beyond 31 and that unfortunate case of typhus and eating a poisoned fish after a mercury treatment that had lowered his immune system. Who knows if he might have found some element of friendship? But he spent most of his life in male company, and nothing delighted him more than the young men who admired his music, Moritz von Schwind. There were numbers of people, particularly the painter Schwind, the composer Franz Lackner, the composer Wetz von Pücklingen. Nowhere do you see his gaze going towards marriage, except we do know that it tormented him that he couldn't be married, that he couldn't be like the others, that he had to go through this. It tormented him that what came so naturally to so many people was so difficult and impossible for him. Well, I think it's important for the modern world to know that classical music had someone who stood up for the others, for the losers, for the people who don't do well, for the people who don't shake their fist at the firmament and receive the Beethovenian mantle. Do you know, after Beethoven died in March 1827, Schubert gave a concert of his works on the day, the very year anniversary, March 1828, that Beethoven had died. And what he was trying to say is, I'm here, the mantle is mine. But he couldn't. He never said, I replace. He never said he was a great composer, and he never, ever matched up to a real man like Beethoven, because his ability to consider himself a real man had been undermined for years. Right from the beginning, right from childhood, right from the lack of parental love. And what are we left with? Songs that were considered feminine. There was prejudice against Schubert's feminine, soft, weak musical personality that went right through to the 1920s. He wasn't a real, you know, a chap, a symphonist. Oh yes, he was a symphonist. Oh yes, he was. Well, he didn't write big choral pieces. Oh yes. There's nothing greater than the A flat and E flat masses. Well, he didn't write piano sonatas like Beethoven. Well, his piano sonatas are wonderful and remarkable pieces of music. Oh, he didn't write string quartets. What? The Death and the Maiden? That's not a string quartet. The great G major, one of the greatest string quartets of all time. Yeah, that's the important thing. He's not a side case of a little petit maître, like Rinaldo Hahn, writing slim and slender melody in the shadow of Marcel Proust. There are plenty of those people, lovely music. He's a great, big, stonking master. But that element that renders him endlessly lovable and endlessly laudable is the fact that he didn't love himself and he didn't push himself. And we all love him far more as a result, in my opinion. And when we sit here day after day learning and looking at the music and looking at the songs, we are in the presence of something blessed and almost supernaturally communicative. He has our devotion, he has our gratitude, and we can embrace him in a way that nobody actually ever dreams of embracing Beethoven. He's up there, he doesn't need our embraces. And Mozart is far too mercurial, he deserves our gratitude and adoration. Interesting thing, ladies and gentlemen, is that society has worked very hard once it accepted that Franz Schubert was not a minor composer of small songs. Really, famous critics like George Bernard Shaw made the stupid judgment. He was a great big master, but he was also someone against the grain, against the time, alternative, and that he existed in the way he did and came through surrounded by that testosteronic multitude of great men, quietly, never praising himself and never vaunting himself. It's one of the miracles of survival. And I think we love him more because in recovering from that illness and devoting himself to music, he showed an enormous depth, integrity of character. And it's that integrity of character that basically shines through everything he does translucently in the music and is the very reason for his place in the world and our ongoing devotion to him. Thank you very much.
So we are so grateful that you have made the long way from the UK to spend a week here. And if you haven't been yet, please, tomorrow, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, Dr. Johnson will work more in master classes, and there also will be a concert on Sunday afternoon. So please, ladies and gentlemen, thank Dr. Johnson again for his marvelous, incredibly inspiring talk.